What a beautiful way to enter into worship. Welcome. Good morning. Good morning. Oh, try that again. Welcome. Good morning.
Good morning.
Oh, you guys are awake. You almost sounded more awake than me. That's even better. Maybe one of you wants to preach today. Oh, they all look down. We're so glad you're here at Seward United Methodist Church. I'm Pastor Joellen, one of the pastors here, and Reverend Mary Kay, if she's online or traveling back. She's been on vacation for 2 weeks, so we're looking forward to seeing her again this week. Hopefully, she's returning renewed and rested and all the things that we love. I believe we have a few announcements. We'll invite you guys on up.
Well, it's time for fashion, fellowship, and fun. And as you can see, I wore Sue's hat to tell you that we're having a fashion show. On May 1st, we're inviting all the women of the church and friends, sisters, anybody that you would like to invite to come with you for a fun time. It's May 1st. At 6 o'clock, there will be a meal. It's $12 for the meal. And then after that, Allure's Fashions will be presenting the program. And we hope to have a few other things happening that night. So we want you all to come, invite somebody to come. I am going to pass around a sheet so you can start to sign up for it. You can pay at the door. If you sign up and you cannot come, please let me know. It has my telephone number on there, too, that you can call. And I can take reservations also. I do. Now, this will be, remember when we used to have the garden party? This will be replacing that. So if you think that's going to be coming up, it will probably be the fashion, fellowship, and fun. So come join us and bring people with you. I have another announcement. Back by demand, we have difficult conversations from hand grenades to handshakes is the name of it. And Jen Davison, we all know Jen Davison, and she's fabulous at this. She has 3 sessions that she's going to be offering, May 2nd, May 9th, and May 23rd. So if you can't make them to all of them, she said, yes, come ahead anyway. But we would like reservations. You can either let me know or there'll be information. There's handouts right at the back with her email that you can write her also. So come and join us, the women, faith, got to get this out right, it changes every time. Seward Faith Women are very busy and are acting and trying to do lots of different programs for all of you. So come join us.
Thank you, Gail. We look forward to all of those exciting times for us to gather for fellowship and also to gather for learning. We know they'll both be wonderful. This coming Wednesday, I've heard, I think it's pasta night for dinner, so we hope you'll join us. Allie Meyer's planning to cook, and she loves to make pasta, so I'm pretty sure it's pasta night from 5 to 6:15. We have 2 more weeks of after-school focus, so we will end on the last Wednesday in April, and we'll have a big church-wide cookout that evening, so if you haven't been all year, don't forget, we got a cookout coming, and everyone's welcome to come and help us celebrate the end of the year. It's just such a fun time for the children to see. We can be together. We can play together. I think the plan is just to play outside and enjoy some fun fellowship. Let me see. Is there any other announcements? I don't think so. I think we're ready to enter into worship. Oh, with passing of peace. Look, I'm still, you would think after all of Lent, I'd be ready. Okay. Y'all ready? Look, I go like this, and y'all are like, she didn't put anything on. Okay, we'll get ready if you want to put some stuff on. We're going to pass the peace of Christ first in American Sign Language, and then I'll invite you to stand and greet one another. Let us pass the peace of Christ. May the peace of Christ be with each of you. Amen. Please stand, greet one another.
right. Hallelujah.
Good morning. Good morning. Thank you. I'd like you to join me in the call to worship. Are you listening? God is doing a new thing. Will you join in?
Yes, we will follow.
Listen, did you miss it? God calls us again to build the kingdom of heaven. Will you join in?
Yes, we will be builders of the kingdom.
Wait. Did you catch that? Again, God calls us to declare the good news to those in need. Will you join us?
Yes.
We will join.
The good news with our voices and our lives.
And still, God calls. God never quits, calling us to live and to give an abundant life. Will you join in? To the world. May we respond to God's loving and persistent call with loving and persistent yes. A yes for us, a yes for our neighbors, and a yes for our world to be transformed by the good news that God's kingdom has come near. Amen. Thank you.
Our hymn this morning will be Bring Forth the Kingdom, which is the Faith We Sing 2190. It's a call and response type of song for the verses, and everyone sings together on the chorus.
You are salt for the earth, O people, salt for the kingdom of God. People, life in the kingdom of God. Bring forth the kingdom of mercy. Bring forth the kingdom of peace. Bring forth the kingdom of justice. Bring forth the city of God. You are a light on the hill, O people, light for the city of God. Shine so holy and bright, O people, shine for the kingdom of God. Bring forth the kingdom of mercy, bring forth the kingdom of peace, bring forth the kingdom of justice, bring forth the city of God. You are a seed for the world, O people, bring forth the kingdom of God. Seeds of mercy and seeds of justice grow in the kingdom of God. Bring forth the kingdom of mercy, bring forth the kingdom of peace, bring forth the kingdom of justice, bring forth the city of God. We are a blessed and a pilgrim people, bound for the kingdom of God. Love our journey and love our homeland, love in the kingdom of God. Bring forth the kingdom of mercy, bring forth the kingdom of peace, bring forth the kingdom of justice, bring forth the city of God.
Please join with me to the opening prayer. Like Jonah, God invites us to tell others of faith. Like Jonah, we sometimes run away. Like Jonah, we sometimes wait until we are in the midst of the darkness of the whale. Like Jonah, we pray and ask for help. Like Jonah, God answers us. Like Jonah, we try again. Like Jonah, we are called. Amen. And amen.
I would invite the children to join me up front, and if you're on the other side of the screen, to squinch a little bit closer. Good morning. Guys, have a seat right here, okay? Have a seat. That's a good spot for you. Come on up. Good morning. I do. I've got new fish. Today, we're going to talk about a different kind of fish. Last time, we talked about how they went fishing. Does anybody remember they caught a whole bunch of fish? Ooh, Hazel, this is beautiful. Do I get to keep this? Thank you. We talked about they caught 153 fish. And remember, you wondered, and we decided maybe they ate them, right?
Yeah, they shared it with the whole world.
They did. They shared the fish. So today we're talking about a different kind of fish. And so I brought my children's Bible because it has really cool pictures. And we're going to hear about Jonah and the big fish. Ready? Jonah was a prophet of God. One day God told Jonah, go to the big city of Nineveh. Tell them to stop doing bad things. You think he's going to go? But Jonah ran away. He did not want to go, did he? He didn't want to go to Nineveh. Instead, he got on a boat and wanted to sail across the sea. God sent a big storm to stop Jonah. The sailors on the boat were afraid. They thought the boat was going to sink. Jonah told the sailors, "My God has sent this storm. If you throw me into the water, the sea will become calm again." So what did he want him to do?
Throw them in.
Do you think they're going to throw him in?
Yeah.
Wait, would you throw Jonah in?
Yeah.
Oh, looky here. Here he goes, right over the edge. So the sailors threw Jonah into the raging sea, and instantly the sea became calm. Just then, Jonah saw a big fish coming. Gulp. The fish swallowed Jonah. You remember reading this one? Oh, for 3 days and three nights, Jonah was inside the fish. He prayed to God, "Please forgive me." Then God told the fish to spit Jonah onto dry land. God told Jonah a second time, "Go and tell the people of Nineveh to stop doing bad things." He did, and then that whale spit him out.
Actually, he sneezed.
You think he sneezed? He might have. This time, Jonah obeyed God. Thank you. The people in Nineveh were sorry for doing bad things, and so God forgave them. Now, I'll tell you what. If I got swallowed by a whale, I'm pretty sure the whale's not going to spit me back out. We don't know if it was a real whale or if it was like he was in a dark place. We don't know about all that. But we do know for sure that when Jonah prayed, God heard Jonah's prayer. And God said, everyone needs a second chance. Do you guys ever need a second chance? Yeah, I saw your faces. Yeah, I need a second chance too. It could have been. We not for sure, are we? Because I wasn't there. Were you there? No, we just have Jonah's word for it, how it all happened. But we do know God heard Jonah's prayer, and Jonah got a second chance. And I think sometimes we all need a second chance. The people in Nineveh that Jonah was supposed to go talk to, they got a second chance. Did you know Jonah only told them five words? he told him something along the lines of, in 40 days, someone's going to come and you're going to be overthrown. That's all he told them. And they took that as a message that they needed to shape up and do better and try again. And so we know they got a second chance. Today, we're going to hear a little bit more about Jonah, how Jonah prayed, and how God answers. After our prayer, I have new fish for you. So if you got fish last week, you get a different color. And then I've got some fishing poles if you weren't here last week, okay?
Let us pray.
Then I'll be sure and get you a fishing pole, okay? Let's pray. Thank you, God, so much for loving us. Thank you, God, for the story of Jonah, that we're reminded when we are in dark places, like in a whale or in times of trouble, we call out to you and you hear us. Thank you, God, for all the times that you give us a second chance. We pray your blessings upon these children. It's in your name. We pray and say together, amen. Okay, if you didn't get a fishing pole last week, get a fishing pole. And I've got new fish, and I did pink. Hazel picked pink fish this week.
Everybody gets one.
Everybody gets one, that's right. And if you didn't get a fishing pole, get a fishing pole.
Okay.
I've got pink fish this week.
The pole's cool.
Okay, here we go.
I saw the pole.
Run it. Some fish. And there's a message on your fish for you, okay? No, we're getting him here. Okay, here. Give this to Kale. Kale needs one. Kale needs one.
Good morning. My name is Mackenzie Martin, and I am so happy to help introduce this Sunday as Native American Ministry Sunday. About 2 years ago, I went to Remember with a couple other members of this church. While we were there, we built bunk beds, and we built outhouses and helped install those outhouses to some of the families on the reservation. This Sunday is very important to me because this helps me remind those families that I helped when I was on the reservation. It is very important to support these types of ministries because it raises awareness to the gifts of the Native Americans gave to us. Now there will be playing a video explaining ministries such like this.
Native American Ministry Sunday is upon us. Observed the second Sunday after Easter on April 14, it is one of six special Sundays that we observe in the United Methodist Church. Created in 1988, this special Sunday is a denominational-wide celebration designed to raise awareness and remind United Methodists of the gifts and contributions made by Native Americans to our society. I have to say that the people of the Great Plains know much about those gifts and contributions as we give the most of any annual conference on this special Sunday. I believe this has been the case for several years. Congratulations and thank you to all of our churches that have recognized this Sunday and collected funds. Funds from this special Sunday help in many ways. We send 25% of what we collect to the General Board of Higher Education and Ministry to provide scholarships to Native American students in seminary and also course of study. I have served on a committee to award scholarships for many years, and it's always a joy to keep up with these candidates as they work towards their degrees. I was honored last year to ordain 22 pastors in the Great Plains Conference at my very first conference in 2023. Among them was Tony Saborsik. Tony is the first Lakota to be ordained in the Great Plains Annual Conference. He is currently serving at First United Methodist Church at Abilene, Kansas. Tony was a recipient of this award for several years. Let's listen to his story.
When I started seminary nearly 10 years ago, I found tuition to be very costly. Seminary can be difficult to fund. Few Native Americans enter seminary due to the lack of financial resources. Through the Native American Seminary Scholarship Fund, I received $60,000 that covered my cost of tuition and associated fees during the time I was in school. Without such aid, I wouldn't have been able to attend seminary. I am so grateful for this scholarship fund and have become an advocate for such scholarships through the United Methodist Global Board of Higher Education and Ministry. It has helped me turn a dream I have had ever since high school into a reality. As you know, there is still a tremendous shortage of Native American clergy within the United Methodist Church. I urge you to consider giving to this special offering for Native American ministries and help make dreams come true for future Native American clergy.
Our Committee on Native American Ministry has been busy with projects to help educate folk on issues that are important to us and also events of the past, which are not always pleasant topics. A gap in knowledge exists in the United Methodist Church and congregations and other United Methodist entities relative to understanding Native American life, cultures, language, spirit, values, contemporary issues, and more. In September of 2023, the committee hosted a Day of Remembrance, which was designed to hear the story of Native American boarding schools of the past and how they still impact Native folk today. About 150 people gathered at Central United Methodist Church in Lawrence, Kansas, to listen to stories and to gather in solidarity with our Native sisters and brothers. CONAM is planning another event for next September near one of our boarding school sites at Genoa, Nebraska. According to records, there were 8 boarding schools in both Nebraska and Kansas. At least 2 of those were connected to the Methodist Church. Listen to Erica Washee Stanley and Denise Estes as they share their work with this committee.
The Committee on Native American Ministries exists to raise awareness of the contributions of Indigenous peoples within our churches and communities. We want to make sure that our voices are being heard.
CONAM would like to be a resource to all congregations within the conference to shed light on our history and current issues facing Native people. All congregations have the opportunity to get involved. CONAM grants are a great way for all churches to get involved in seeking justice and pursuing the truth about our people and communities.
This grant money can provide congregations materials for book studies from Indigenous authors, Native American guest speakers or musicians for your congregations, and other programs like community gardens and cultural programming.
50% of what we collect from this special Sunday stays in the Great Plains Conference for events such as the Boarding School Remembrance. The committee is working to award funds to special projects that relate to Native Americans. 25% goes to scholarships, and the last 25% goes to fund ministry projects for Native Americans through the General Board of Global Ministries. These projects have ranged from supporting young Native Americans to events such as Youth 23, to funds to create a Native American exhibit in the lower level concourse of the Atlanta airport. I thank you in advance for taking time to observe this Sunday in some manner in your local church. It can be through music, speakers, litanies, and more. When I visited with the clergy and lay people at the United Methodist Church in Coffeyville, I was pleasantly surprised by the youth group. They learned a verse of Cherokee and Choctaw, Amazing Grace. They did a wonderful job, and I was so happy they took time to learn those hymns in honor of myself. Thank you for your great ministry and for recognizing this special Sunday.
Today's scripture lesson comes from Jonah 1:17 to 2:10. God provided a large fish to swallow up Jonah, and Jonah was in the belly of the fish 3 days and 3 nights. Then Jonah prayed to the Lord his God from the belly of the fish, saying, "I called to God out of my distress, and he answered me. Out of the belly of Sheol I cried, and you heard my voice. You cast me into the deep, into the heart of the seas, and the floods surrounded me. All your waves and your billows passed over me. Then I said, 'Am I driven away from your sight? How shall I look again upon your holy temple?' The waters closed in over me, the deep surrounded me, the weeds wrapped around my head, and the roots of the mountains. I went down to the land whose bars closed upon me forever. Yet you brought up my life from the pit, O Lord, my God, as my life was ebbing away. I remembered God, and my prayer came to you into your holy temple. Those who worship vain idols forsake their true loyalty, but I, with the voice of thanksgiving, will sacrifice to you what I have vowed, and I will pay. Deliverance belongs to God.' Then God spoke to the fish, and it spit Jonah out into the dry land." The word of God spoken for the people of God.
Thank you.
call me out upon the waters, the great unknown, where feet may fail. And there I find you in the mystery, in oceans deep, my faith will stand. And I will call upon your name, and keep my eyes above the waves. When oceans rise, my soul will rest in your embrace, for I am yours, and you are mine. And grace abounds in deepest waters, your sovereign hand will be my guide. Where fears that fail and fear surrounds me, you've never failed, and you won't start now. So I will call upon your name, and keep my eyes above the waves. When oceans rise, my soul will rest in your embrace, for I am yours, and you are mine. Spirit, lead me where my trust is without borders. Let me walk upon the waters, wherever you would call me. And take me deeper than my feet could ever wander, and my faith will be made stronger in the presence of my Savior. Spirit, lead me waters. Let me walk upon the waters, wherever you would call me. And take me deeper than my feet could ever wander, and my faith will be made stronger in the presence of my Savior. I will call upon your name, keep my eyes above the waves. My soul will rest in your embrace, for I am yours, and you are mine.
I love that one. Thank you, Alex. Thank you, Wes. Love that when we sing together, there's power in the words, and they speak to us. Let us pray. God, we thank you for Jonah and this story of this fish. God, we too have been in dark places, and we seek your guidance when we pray. We thank you that we never walk without you, that you are with us in those places. We thank you for the ways that you speak through scripture and music. We thank you for this church community, for the fellowship, for the learning, and for the love. God, we continue to ask your watch care over each of us. It's in your name we pray and say together. Amen. So last week, we talked a little about going fishing, and not just fishing for fish, but fishing for people. We met Jesus there on the beach post-resurrection. And so this week, we're hopping all the way back into the Old Testament to find Jonah. If you haven't read the book of Jonah lately, I encourage you to do so. It's only 4 chapters, y'all. anybody can read 4 whole chapters, and yes, I read a whole book in the Bible. It is a wonderful group of scripture, but it's not just about the fish or a whale or a big something that swallowed up Jonah. It's about Jonah the prophet. Now, we would tell you, and most theologians would tell you, that prophets didn't sign up and say, "Yes, God, pick me to be a prophet," because a prophet's voice carried weight, and it also carried responsibility. And so we meet Jonah in chapter 1, ahead of where we read today, and God tells Jonah, "Go to Nineveh. Those folks are doing some really bad things. Go to Nineveh, tell them to repent, because I want to love them like they need to be loved." And Jonah says, "No, those people are bad people. How dare God want to forgive them?" Now, we don't find that part out until a little later in Jonah, but Jonah is thinking this, and so Jonah runs away. Jonah decides, "I'm not going to do what God said to do, and instead I'm going to do what I want to do, and I don't want to forgive those people, so God should not forgive them either." So I want you to think in your head of someone who you know or don't know personally, but someone who's done something really horrific that probably does not deserve forgiveness, like people forgiveness. Do you have that person in your head? You have it? Okay, this is where Jonah was in Jonah's head. Jonah said, "There is no way that God could forgive the things the people of Nineveh have been doing, so I'm going somewhere else." So we know that he gets on a boat and he wants to go to Tarshish, which is the opposite direction. So Nineveh's over here and Tarshish is over here. And he's going to go far away from where he was supposed to go because he does not think God should be forgiving people who do these really horrific things. So he gets on the boat and a storm happens, much like a storm happens in the New Testament when Jesus is on the boat. God sends this wind, and the storm gets bad. And the sailors on the boat are looking around like, "Who did this? Whose fault is this?" And they're looking and they can't decide. So they cast lots and they decide it's Jonah. So they go down and they say, "Jonah, what have you done that would give this kind of storm to us? You're going to kill us." Jonah knows what Jonah has done. And Jonah says, "Throw me over. That will please my God, and the storm will go away." Now, I don't know about you. I'm all about being sacrificial. This is really sacrificial. Just throw me over. Because you see, Jonah's like, "I'd rather just die than have to go tell those people that God wants to love you too. So just throw me in. Let me drown. It'll be over." They throw him in. And the storm stops, and the waves go away. And the sailors probably are saying, "We knew it was him. His God is now happy." Now, we know in Scripture that the sailors repent and decide to praise God, all the while Jonah is sinking down, 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 down. And in Scripture, it tells us God sent a big fish to swallow him. Now, I don't know if it was a real fish or not. Maybe it was. I wasn't there. All we have is Jonah's word for this. It was a big fish. But it could have been a big, dark place. Have you ever been in a big, dark place? Perhaps pain or anxiety or war or things awful like the Holocaust or the Israel people being in exile, those kinds of dark places. That's where Jonah was. And we know for 3 days and 3 nights, Jonah was in this big, dark place. Did we hear 3 last week? Something tells me we did, didn't we? There's that three again, and three tells us there's something about to happen that will bring new life, something changing, life-changing. And so Jonah's in this deep, dark pit. Now, Corrie Ten Boom tells us that there is no pit so deep that God is not deeper still. And so I imagine that when Jonah was in that deep, dark pit, feeling swallowed up, it didn't feel very hopeful. It didn't feel very, oh, I'm doing what God wants me to do kind of feeling. And so this is where we are in our scripture today in chapter 2. It's a psalm of thanksgiving. Chapter 2 starts off, then Jonah prayed to the Lord his God from the belly of the fish, saying, I called to the Lord out of my distress, and he answered me. In the belly of my distress, God answered me. I don't know if any of you today are feeling like you're in the belly of a whale, that deep, dark pit. But I do know beyond a doubt that God promises in this scripture to answer you, to not leave you there alone. Perhaps God will sit in the pit with you. Perhaps God will call you out of that pit. As he is in there and he is praying, we know that God responds. And in verse 10, it says, then the Lord spoke to the fish and it spewed Jonah out onto the dry land. It spit him out. When I'm in a dark place, I want God to spit me out of that dark place. Because I know that the God I serve, the God I call Jehovah Rapha, the God who heals, can heal my soul as well as my body. And I know that God answers. Ren Collective has a beautiful song called Second Chances. And in the verse and in the repetition, you hear countless second chances. Second chances. It was a reminder that we all need a do-over. Now, when our kids were little, we called it a do-over instead of second chances. And I would look right at them and say, do you need a do-over? And they would usually say, yes, I do. I need a do-over, Mom. I need a do-over. Jonah needed a do-over. The people of Nineveh who were doing the really bad, awful things needed a do-over. That person in your head needed a do-over. And none of these do-overs are too big for our Jesus. None of these do-overs are too big for God. And so we read in scripture, God spoke to the fish, whatever your fish is, and it spewed Jonah out upon the dry land. Where was Jonah when he got in the fish? Where was he? The water, right? He was down in the water. It was dark. I am sure it was horrifyingly scary. But then he was encased. But when the fish released Jonah, where was he? On the dry land. You see, God won't leave us drowning in the water. It may feel like that, but I know that our God will be there with us in the drowning water. We'll walk alongside us. And when God spits us back out, it will be on dry land, wherever that dry land might be. Now, for Jonah, guess where it was? Where was he supposed to go? Nineveh. And guess where the dry land was? Nineveh. Does God not have a sense of humor? Most theologians say that the book of Jonah is great satire because Jonah wants to go where God does not want him to go. And guess where he ends up anyway? Right where he was supposed to be. Now, we're not going to cover the last couple chapters, and I would encourage you to cover them on your own. But when he gets there, he tells them all of five words, y'all, five whole words. And the whole town repents over those five words. He essentially tells them, be ready, somebody's going to destroy you. Good luck, right? Good luck with that. I didn't want to come here. I don't want to forgive you. I don't think God should forgive you. Y'all are awful. He didn't say all that. He just says five words. Something bad's going to happen. People are coming to destroy you. And they repent. Because what they heard in those five words was God still loves us. As bad as we are, as awful as we are, God still loves us. You have that person still in your head who probably doesn't deserve any kind of forgiveness. God still loves that person. You see where Jonah was? Jonah's like, really? Really, you forgive that person? Really? They were pretty, We're all a little bit like Jonah, aren't we? We are. Jonah says, I cried out and God answered me, much like a psalm. I know God is faithful and he knows God will save him. And this is huge because God helps him to be thrown out, spewed out. It's a little ironic because God holds true to the covenant that there is hope for all the people. And Jonah might be faithful, but he doesn't want God to help all the people. I think we can be like that. Let's God just help those who help themselves. We've heard that, right? God, let's just help those who are easy to love. Let's just help those people. God, let's help those who are just like me. Let's not help the people who aren't like me. God, should we help everyone? Or is it more like we should be saying, God, help those who hurt other people. God, help those people who do bad things. God, love those who are evil. This is hard stuff in Jonah, because the truth is, we're a little bit like Jonah. We don't want people to have forgiveness for doing these really, truly awful things, but these people need mercy. And mercy is different than forgiveness. Mercy is something we don't deserve. Justice is something we do deserve. But mercy is something we don't deserve. And our God, the God you and I worship, is a God of mercy who gives people what they don't deserve. Because if we want to be honest, I don't deserve the love that Jesus gives me. I don't deserve a place in heaven. There is nothing I could ever do that would be good enough. Not one thing. But yet I, a sinner, have received mercy. I want to worship a God like that. And yet that's hard, right? Because that person in your head deserves mercy. My prayer today is that you'll dive a little deeper with Jonah. You might go back and read all four chapters. Just read the whole book and see if you find yourself in there. As I close today, I love this book of prayers. I've shared from it before, The Lives We Actually Have by Kate Bowler and Jessica Ritchie. And in this prayer, they speak to for when hope seems lost. Hope is only a half-remembered dream behind a closed door. All is lost. God, this reality is a current so strong, I feel certain, at least for now, that it will sweep us all away. Could you bless this honesty that feels like despair? Can we whisper that? Somehow blessed are we, the spirit starved for what is good. Allow our eyes to see the small, sealed space where pain has isolated me. We cry, God, help me. I can't break out of this, so please break in. Cut through the walls of this hard prison. Sorry, allergies. And flood it with the light of your presence. Make prayer as natural as breathing to release to you all that I know and think and feel, and inhale deeply some of the goodness and strength. Blessed are we when we realize that suddenly, already, you never leave. You insisted on bringing life and hope and truth into my lungs, filling everything until the pain dissolves and I am free to move in faith again. Blessed are we who have a glimmer of certainty that in that dark expanse, and as sure as day follows night, hope returns. P.S. Take a deep breath. Let a yawn come and another. See what new things begin all by itself. You see, Jonah didn't release hope, but Jonah clung to God. 3 days, 3 nights in a pit of despair. God, please save me. Save me a sinner just as I am. God love me. Amen? And amen.
Please join me in the prayer of confession and assurance of pardon. Holy One, what a blessing and privilege we share here in this sacred space among this living community. But like Jonah, we sometimes are jealous of what we share here. We know that others are longing and thirsting for what we know and experience. Forgive us our reluctance to open our doors, open our hearts to others, some like us, some not. We repent in our hesitations and unwillingness to witness to those we have considered strangers and enemies for fear they might just be friends. Amen. The one who calls us to this place calls us to reconciliation through grace. God will not deny a repentant heart or an open spirit. Know that you are forgiven and walk in the new way that is made known to you in God's love. Amen.
As we prepare for a time of prayer, we'll invite you to consider sharing your joys and concerns, those things that are on your heart, that we might walk alongside you in this faith community. Those on the other side of the screen can type those in or text them to the church line. Let us enter into prayer through song.
Depth of mercy, can there be mercy still reserved for me? Doth thy God his wrath forbear? Me, the chief of sinners, spare. Me, the chief of sinners, spare. Of worse thoughts would his grace long provoked him to his face, would not hearken to his calls, grieved him by a thousand falls, grieved him by a thousand falls. I my master have denied, I afresh have crucified, oft profaned his hallowed name, put him to an open shame, put him to an open shame. There for me the Savior stands, shows his wounds and spreads his hands. God is love, I know, I feel. Jesus lives and loves me still. Jesus lives and loves me still.
Our acolytes will bring the microphones around. If you'll just wave your hand if you'd like to lift up a joy or a concern. Ruby, there's some over there too, both sides.
My grandpa I just got surgery, so I hope I'm well.
He got surgery, and so we're going to keep praying for healing, right? Okay. God, in your mercy.
Hear our prayers.
Thank you.
I have prayers of concern for two friends.
For both of these, God, for this, and God, in your mercy.
Hear our prayers.
And I celebrate my girlfriend Betty Olson becoming a grandmother for the first time ever when baby girl Sloan Olson was born over the last about 10 days ago.
Congratulations. God, for this.
We give you thanks.
As for prayers for healing and care, my brother is going to find out his path for treatment of cancer this week, and also prayers for a family I'm acquainted with in Omaha who lost a child last week.
God, in your mercy.
I lift up prayers for my mom, Sherry, who has been in the hospital since Thursday evening with blood clots in both of her lungs, and so just trying to work through that.
God, in your mercy.
We've been celebrating at our home this weekend. Steve celebrated his birthday yesterday, and he will not be turning on his alarm for tomorrow because he retired on Friday.
Yay! God, for this. Let us continue in prayer. God, you are good even when we are in the deepest, darkest pit. We know that you don't leave us there alone. We know that you stand with us, sit with us, hold us, and cry with us. God, in your mercy, release us. Spit us back out where we can heal and be whole again. We pray for those who need your healing and wholeness, those who are having surgeries, those who have had illnesses, those who claim you and love you, and even those who don't. Heal us all. God, we thank you for the joys of new grandbabies and the joys of birthdays and graduations and retirement. Oh, God, these journeys give us joy, and we give you joy. And we thank you. God, please be with us in those heart-sick days with the loss of a child and the loss of a loved one. We pray for healing and wholeness in all the ways that you can bring that. God, we too are Jonah. We sometimes can't understand how there is mercy for those we think don't deserve it. But God, you are good. None of us deserve that kind of mercy. Forgive us. God, we love you, and we thank you for teaching us to pray and to say together, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. We come to the time in our worship where we give back. We give back not only of our tithes and offerings, but also of our gifts, our prayers, our presence, our service, and our witness. Let us give back.
Let's pray the prayer of dedication. Generous God, we ask you to bless the gifts we give this morning. We ask that you help grow the trust in us so that we might follow without looking back, and we might leave behind more of our old lives to experience more deeply new life in you. Help us to leave our nets on the shore and leave those things that seemed essential before we heard the call, so that we might travel the road you have put before us. In the name of Christ, who goes before us, we pray. Amen.
Lord, you have come to the lake shore, looking neither for wealthy nor wise ones. You only asked me to follow humbly.
Teamwork. Good job, guys. As we prepare to leave, know that God loves you so much that he will seek you out in the deepest of pits. Know that you never walk alone, and know that you are deeply loved. Amen?
Amen.
Amen.